This is a puzzle where you try to fit 27 of these rhombuses in a hexagon-shaped hole. If it looks easy, it's because it is. This is actually a toy for babies. Each rhombus is two equilateral triangles, so the only way you could really mess it up is if you separate two of the triangles. Even then, it's pretty straightforward to fix as long as you're trying to fill the empty space. One of the reasons it's easy to solve is because there are so many valid solutions. For a hexagon with side lengths A, B, and C, the number of ways to arrange these rhombuses is the product from 1 to A, of the product from 1 to B, of the product from 1 to C, of A plus B plus C minus 1, over A plus B plus C minus 2. So for a 3x3x3 hexagon, we get 980 ways to solve this puzzle. Of course, ignoring the different colors of pieces. For the colors, you might as well only use three, because there are three different ways that you can orient a piece and still solve the puzzle. In fact, you might as well only have nine of each color, because if the whole is a hexagon, every way of solving the puzzle will have the same amount of each of the three types. Because you're a human, whose eyes were trained to see things in a 3D world, you probably can't help thinking about these tiles as a stack of cubes. Rather than a perspective projection, where parallel lines vanish into a point and objects look smaller when they're farther away, these rhombuses form an isometric projection. Lines that are parallel in 3D are still parallel in 2D. That doesn't mean that you can make any configuration of cubes out of rhombuses, though. If a cube is in front of another without a third cube between them, you end up leaving a triangle exposed, so every solution to your puzzle will be a stack of cubes that always starts in the back corner, and never has a hidden empty cube. So if you look at your puzzle from one of the three edges, you should see an entirely filled square of one color. That's why every solution has the same number of each color of lozenges. Oh, by the way, I'm going to start sometimes calling rhombuses lozenges. If you put all 980 solutions to this puzzle into a hat and pull out a random one, what will it typically look like? Let's try it a few times. To be honest, I don't really see any pattern. Let's make the hexagon bigger and try again. A 4x4x4 has 232,848 solutions, a 5x5x5 has 267,227,532, and a 20x20x20 has a whopping 10 to the 136 ways of tiling lozenges. That's more than Google, and more than the number of atoms in the universe. Let's try it for a 20x20x20. You might be skeptical that it's even possible to get a random sample when there are such an insane number of tilings to choose from, but just trust me for now. Look at the pictures. Do you see a pattern? The lozenges tend to form a circle. We get this region in the middle that has a good mix of different colors, but outside the circle we get only one color at a time. We say that these regions of only one color are frozen. These images are pushing the limits of what my computer can handle, but as the hexagon gets bigger, the boundary between frozen and liquid regions becomes a perfect circle. If the hole is shaped like a hexagon with different side lengths, then the so-called Arctic curve is an ellipse. If the puzzle is some other shape, of course one that is tileable, then the boundary is some curve that's tangent to each side. So far, we've been assuming that the distribution of these tilings is uniform, so each one has the same probability of being picked. Naturally, if we choose a different probability distribution, the typical shape of the Arctic curve will also be different. For example, let's make it so the probability of picking a tiling is higher when the total number of cubes is lower. This is what a sample might look like. The really cool thing is that the Arctic curve is still tangent to the sides. In fact, mathematicians are able to find an exact expression for this curve. Finding these Arctic curves is really one of the big reasons that we care about baby toys with rhombuses in the first place. They're a system of a lot of puzzle pieces and a lot of possible solutions that we can solve for exactly. In physics, this isn't that common. A lot of problems just don't have an exact solution, so it's useful to compare real things that we see, things like salt stacking in the corner of a box or water freezing, to toy problems that we can solve. But all of this is a lot less useful if we need to generate all 10 to the 136 solutions in order to get a picture like this. So how did I make this picture without spending trillions of years on a supercomputer? I could just come up with whatever solution is in my head, but the problem with that is it definitely won't be a uniform random sample. A human will probably tend to solve it in an orderly way. We need a way to sample from a uniform distribution without generating every tiling in a uniform distribution. To do that, we use a class of methods called Markov Chain Monte Carlo. The idea is that we start with some arbitrary sample, then one step at a time, we make a random transition to a new state. That means that each state depends on the last one, so we get a chain. After doing this many times, our results start to be samples from our desired distribution. Here's how we apply MCMC to our lozenges. We start with whatever tiling we want, but I think the most natural is with the tiles arranged like this to look like an empty cube. Then we pick a random point on the hexagonal grid of triangle vertices and we flip a coin. If heads, we add a cube, and if tails, we remove a cube. If it's impossible to add or remove a cube, you just ignore it. Do this over and over many times, and the result will be a uniformly selected sample of all of the possible tilings. When we start with an empty cube, there's actually only one point in the entire puzzle that's allowed to be switched, that's the center. But you can see that once we add a cube there, we can now legally add a cube in any of the three spots surrounding it. So you can reach every possible tiling just by swapping an empty cube hexagon with a full cube hexagon one at a time. This is way faster than generating every possible tiling and picking one randomly. Using that method without any tricks would take my computer longer than the age of the universe to make this picture right here, but with the algorithm that I just described, it takes less than an hour. People much smarter than me have made really beautiful simulations of lozenge tilings. If you want to see more, you should check out Leonid Petrov. I think most people recognize that there's some kind of educational value in things like this baby toy, or jigsaw puzzles, or Tetris, or cat stacks. But just in case you think they're a waste of time, I hope this video is a reminder that mathematicians, and sometimes physicists, do this stuff. In part because we learn methods that can be applied to other problems while we do it, but also because it's cool. A lot of the time, being aesthetic, or interesting, or beautiful is the only reason you need to make learning about something worth it. Thank you to all the viewers who support me on Patreon. These people have really gone out of their way to help out. I know that math and physics videos are less easy to watch than a lot of stuff out there, so thanks for watching.